The Almost Perfect Podcast.
Welcome to the Almost Perfect Podcast, a celebration of fuck-ups, failures, and falling flat on your face. This is a podcast that believes you can learn from experience, but that experience doesn't have to be your own. Hi, I'm Bob Perfect, and I'm a functional fuck-up. Let's learn from somebody else's mistakes. And today we're learning from Carvin Goldstone. Now, Carvin Goldstone is a comedian, and I'm pretty certain you know who he is. He's one of the most successful comedians in South Africa, and definitely the most successful comedian to come out of Durban, I think. But yeah, Carvin is he was the first guest on the Almost Perfect podcast. Wasn't the first one recorded, but it was the first one released. And yeah, man, I've got so much time and so much love for Carvin, and he's someone who I talk to fairly often. Like, throughout the year, we'll have some long conversations. We'll have some coffees, or not recently, but from time to time, yeah, we meet up, we talk, we've had similar vibes at times. He's just way more successful than me. But, like, yeah, I get Carvin, I think, and I think Carvin gets me to some degree. And, yeah, this is a cool conversation where Carvin is very, very, very open and honest. And I think there's a lot of value in that for various different people, but especially for younger comics, I think, and for people who want to know how the comedy industry works or how selling a special works. Those are some of the things that come up on this conversation. So yeah, Carvin is incredibly forthcoming and is a deep thinker, and he's been thinking quite deeply lately. He's actually, you'll see in the podcast, but he's been enjoying lockdown, and he was planning on chilling this year anyway. He wasn't planning on traveling much this year, so lockdown kind of came at a good time for him, but it has also helped him realize more things about himself. And yeah, we get into it. Of course we get into it. That's what we do on this podcast. But Carvin and I have a lot of similarities, I think, at the moment, or at least are on a similar wavelength with where our minds have gone with regards to, yeah, the lockdown. Because we chat about it in this podcast, but I've also been feeling the need to withdraw from the public, if that makes sense, even though, once again, like, it's not like I have a gigantic audience or, you know, adoring fans or anything like that. But I've really been thinking a lot about just, like, online life and stuff like that. And I've withdrawn from that quite a lot over the last little while. And it's been interesting, you know. It's, like, not necessarily, like, you think, oh yeah, this will be great. This is gonna teach me a lot about myself, or get me more in touch with other things. I'm gonna be more productive, but not necessarily, you know. You can feel, for me personally, a little bit lonely, because you're not engaging with people constantly. You're not as in the zeitgeist as you were before. Once again, just for me personally, but it has allowed me time to focus on other things and to dig deeper into myself, I guess. So yeah, we don't necessarily chat about that, but Carvin does chat about, yeah, why he wants to withdraw from the public and why things have at least been okay for him when it comes to this thing that we're all dealing with. But in the beginning of the lockdown, like a lot of us, you know, he was also caught up in the race to create content. And I think, yeah, a lot of comedians and a lot of musicians and a lot of artists might relate to some of the stuff we talk about there. And then what else we get into? We get into the Winston, man. And this is, I let Carvin talk for the most part when it came to this, because it's a bit of a sore point for me at this point, I think. If I'm honest about it, like, because I agree with a lot of what Carvin says later on when it comes to, you know, it should have been appreciated more. And I feel maybe even I didn't appreciate it enough, but, like, fuck, did the comedians that came and performed, they're not appreciated anywhere near enough. And that's essentially why I stopped doing it. Like, it was just a headache to organize every single week and to have it be unappreciated by the people that you're doing it for. Just sucks. So yeah, like I feel a little salty when it comes to the Durban comedy scene, and we do discuss that at the end. And because I've made one or two statuses on Facebook about it, and I don't necessarily think that's a big deal, because Carvin posted a little while ago about how he misses the Winston and stuff, and I was like, I don't fucking miss the Winston, because, you know, it's Durban comedians are joke thieves and just ungrateful assholes and blah 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 blah. I had a little vent, and yeah, maybe people got touched by that, but like, the way I feel is like, you'll only get touched by that if you were one of the shitty comics that made my life a fucking nightmare for that period of time. So, you know, fuck you if you did, and if you didn't, if you were cool and we're cool, then we're cool. I don't think it should necessarily be an issue, and I still want to do comedy. I still want to do comedy with lots of comedians. I'm still cool with lots of comedians. I'm sure there's quite a few of them listening now. And yeah, man, like, I just don't feel the need to necessarily just share the fucking Durban love thing that we've all lied to ourselves about over the years, because yeah, man, some things suck and some people suck, and I'm going to be honest about that. But at the same time, I'm not going to, you know, throw, and maybe I need to be a bit more pointed with my words, and I don't need to be like, Durban comedy is shit. Because Durban comedy isn't shit. There's just some people within Durban comedy who I don't fuck with. And yeah, so that's what we've got coming up on the podcast. This is a listener-supported podcast, which means it is brought to you by you. We're going to patreon.com/almostperfect. Yeah, there's multiple tiers that you can go to there. And just go check that out yourself. You can also go to almostperfect.co.z. There is a QR code there. You can scan it, and there's multiple different things that you can choose to pay me if you just want to give me a bit of money. If you enjoy this, if you get some value out of these conversations each and every single week, then maybe you could throw a few shekels into the collection plate and help out a little bit at Almost Perfect headquarters. Help keep the lights on here a little bit. We're also selling mugs. They are 100 Rand. They just say Almost Perfect on them. They've got the logo there. And yeah, 10 Rand from each mug sale goes to sasonke.org.za. Well, just to Sasonke, but you can find out more about them at sasonke.org.za. And we can deliver those to you. They are 100 Rand via Postnet to Postnet. I am working, well, I'm looking at international options, but at the moment it's very expensive, and just, you know, we'll chat. If you're from overseas, hit me up. I keep on doing my old email address, bob@almostperfect.co.z. Hit me up. We can chat wherever you are in the world. We can figure out how to get a mug to you, but they're kind of fragile, so yeah, sailing them across the world's a bit of a mission. How are you doing? I hope you've had a good week. I have not had a good week, unfortunately. And yeah, like, it's time for me to be honest with you just about some shit that's going on in my life, I guess, because I might take a break from the podcast from time to time over the next little while, because my grandfather has cancer and is, yeah, in the final stages of that whole thing. And my gran is struggling to deal with it because they can't really get help and stuff in. And yeah, so this week I offered to quarantine and then go live there for a while and try and help out. And they said no. yeah, silly reasons, I guess. But we'll see if they change their minds in the next little while. And yeah, see how all of that goes. But that's been on my mind a lot at the moment. and it's just been a lot to deal with. He's not like my actual grandfather in that, you know, not biological, but he's been with my grand my entire life. And so he's, yeah, the only male figure I've really had growing up. And, you know, interesting guy. But, yeah, it's not a cool time. I'm not having the best time with regards to that. And then, you know, I've just also, yeah, the withdrawing from social media thing, maybe not at the best time, but also, like, I don't know. Like, I don't want to perform grief online, even though, you know, kind of doing it here. But I feel like this is just my space where, yeah, I get to do this, I guess. Although, I'm not Marc Maron. I don't think I'm going to fill you in every week on how I'm doing with regards to this. I don't want to live, you know, public life or, you know, their life publicly, because, yeah, it's a rough time, and it's just been rough for my grand for a long time, and that shit is relentless, and it sucks, and it's been getting to me. So, yeah, that's where I'm at. I'll be honest with you, and I'm grateful that I did this podcast with Carbon last week instead of this week, because I don't know if I would have been able to do it this week. So, yeah, I'm grateful I got some work. I'm doing some copywriting and that, but that's been pretty difficult to do with all of this on my mind. And yeah, so I might take a bit of a break from time to time from the podcast, but also it's wonderful to have this to work on. Like, doing the edits for this was so cool. Also, just because Carvin is so rad, and just this conversation was, you know, sometimes when I edit this podcast, I take breaks, you know, it'll be like, cool, do 20 minutes. And you might not even notice that stuff is edited, because I do still leave some ums and likes and stuff like that in, but I take a lot of them out. You just hopefully don't notice that. But with this conversation, yeah, man, I just hit play and went through the whole thing. And so, you know, doing this and doing some work and trying to do other things, it's been cool to have other things to focus on. Like, I made the mistake of doing yoga without any music the other day, with all of this stuff going on in my mind, and that was not a good idea. It's definitely better, well, maybe it's not better, but I don't know. I'm trying to just keep my mind busy. I'm trying to keep, yeah, myself occupied and stuff. But yeah, there is that looming specter. And I know a lot of people are dealing with so fucking much at the moment. So yeah, my thoughts are with you. I know this is a tough time for a lot of us for so many different reasons. And yeah, I guess that's my thing. It's a little awkward because I've got to fucking now shill the Patreon thing again, but I'm gonna give the shout outs, man. So if you are on patreon.com/almostperfect, there is a tier there called the titular titles tier. It's a $10 tier, and you get to pick your title on this podcast. You become a member of the cast and crew. And so we've got 4 people at that tier currently. We've got the Chief Sales Officer of Subtle Heresies in the Greater Overberg Region. That is Rousseau. We've got Karan Sleman, who is the Almost Perfect Youth Group Leader. Also, he's got a new website. I should have written it down. I think it's parable.co.z. That's parable.co.z or .com. Just put that in. Hopefully you find it. If not, just search for Parable on Twitter or Facebook and you'll find the link there. He's sharing info when it comes to SEO, when it comes to website development, and his music. So yeah, dope dude, really cool vibes, and just, yeah, talented as fuck. So go check out his shit. And yeah, shout outs to you, the Almost Perfect Youth Group Leader. Also, shout outs to King Julian. Your support is always appreciated. And then shout outs to Stephen Olafia, one of the people at the Winston who appreciated, you know, the space that he had. So shout outs to Stephen Olafia, who is the executive producer of the Almost Perfect podcast. Yeah, so that's all fucking weird. And I feel a little uncomfortable sharing all of that. But at the same time, this is kind of a weird little fucking diary thing. And yeah, I guess also with me withdrawing from everything, maybe this is the only way people are gonna know how I'm doing or what I'm doing or what's going on in my life. So I might as well let people know somehow, because I'm sure as fuck not doing it any other way. Anyway, that was the intro, and here comes the Almost Perfect podcast with Carvin Goldstone.
So how are you living, Carvin?
I'm good, Bob. I'm enjoying lockdown, if that makes any sense.
You're enjoying the lockdown? What do you mean you're enjoying the lockdown?
So, you know, when it first started, there was a little bit of panic from all of us because we didn't know how this was going to work out.
I think some people are still panicking.
Yeah. Let's say I was part of that group that was panicking quite a bit. Of course, you're thinking of it from a financial perspective, from a social perspective. And as it unfolded, I started to realize that I was so busy for so long that I needed a break, and it was forced on me. And this is personal, right? I completely get that it's been devastating for a lot of people. I was probably, sorry, my door's just banging it.
It's all good. That's part of the new normal. That's part of the new way we do things these days. Like, I know I've been listening to podcasts with like Marc Maron and stuff, and hearing these super famous actors and actresses, you know, busy talking to their kids, like whilst they're being interviewed.
Oh, yeah, we won't have that today. And so, I don't know what everyone's like work output is, but I kept mine pretty high for a long time. Yeah, because of that, I almost was in automatic mode when it came to working. And so I forgot what it was like to not have things to do. I'd go away sometimes and work on the cruise ship. What a hard job. Anyway. And I'd be away.
Hey, thankfully, you went on a cruise ship when you went, like, now, like during the like the early stages of Corona. You know,
well, I was, actually. We'll talk about that in a bit. And while I was away, I didn't have phone access. And I should always think to myself, how I'm away for 2 weeks. And whoever needed me and whoever needed to talk to me so desperately just can't talk to me. And then I'd come back. Like, from the day I'm back, every, like, few minutes, I need this, I need that. And a lot of these things are not even like money related. It's just people needing all sorts of things, conversations or advice or whatever. So I developed this way of living where I was constantly busy. Now that the pandemic has locked us down, I kind of realized that being inside and being away from the public is actually not something I miss. And it took a while, right? Because you're basically supposed to want the lockdown to end. All of us. We're supposed to want things to go back to normal, because when things go back to normal, we earn money and we're able to buy. And, you know, there's reasons why you're supposed to want it. But the more I've been in it, the more I realize how much I prefer an isolated life. In fact, to the point where I've been trying to think of how do I escape public life altogether? I haven't hatched a plan yet.
Bro, holy shit. You and I are in such a similar space right now. Like, even though I'm not as big as you or anything like that, if there's one thing that this whole thing has really made me think about a lot, it's public life, it's the internet, it's public persona, it's parasocial relationships. It's all these things that, you know, our industry is about and what we're told to do. You know, we're told to constantly, and especially now in this pandemic, you know, we were told shift to video, you know, start putting out more content online, start creating stuff, put it out online. And then it became this huge rat race, like at the beginning of lockdown. And I guess it's still happening now, you know, to create this content, to shift from where we were as comedians getting on stage and try to find new avenues because it wasn't going to be possible. But I've just been thinking so much about like how that's not what I want to do. I don't want to fucking put out like a funny video every day. I want to put out one funny video for a year and have that be like an hour long fucking thing that's a considered, well thought out, well produced piece of art, more than constantly having to engage with people, you know?
Yeah. And so I was one of those people who was straight out the gates in full steam. I had about 4 or 5 online products. I had Bar for Bar, which was like a music review, COVID Conversations, which was our weekly, bi-weekly, twice a week conversation with industry and a bit of comedy inserts, late night TV kind of style, but not as good as any of the ones that are out there. I mean, I was doing my own comedy videos and I was literally all over the place.
So you were doing a lot in the beginning there, but was that because you were so used to doing a lot? Like you said, you know, yeah, before this, you were just like, I need to just do more.
I was in the rhythm of doing a lot, and I do think a lot. So also I'm a bit impulsive. So if I have an idea, I do it immediately. And then later figure out that this is not sustainable.
I've kind of been in those situations too.
But I won't stop doing something and then like thinking, oh, this might not be. I'll do it and then rather figure out, oh, this is not sustainable. But I'll do it. I always get out the gates. That's one thing you can depend on me.
That's pretty punk rock of you, like. That is like a punk rock philosophy. It's just like do the thing, you know, and then figure out if it's sustainable.
We'll realize, oh, okay, it wasn't such a sustainable. Sometimes it's not that it's like not a great idea. It's just not sustainable. Anyway, today actually I got a call from Mo Samoka, who runs comedy, and also produced a lot of my shows. And he was telling me about some online projects he's doing, comedy projects, and a lot of the comedians or people in that space are not producing anything, even though there's this rat race, there's this big corner of the comedy community who have done nothing since lockdown. They've not produced anything because, you know, it's not as simple to just jump online. And people are taking the L's online. You know, I've watched comedians performing to 3 people, and it's painful. It's painful as a performer. It's also funny a little bit because, you know, you have to keep going.
It's also but the problem here is like when, you know, we used to do gigs to like 5 people in Durban, which has happened. I mean, I've done a gig to 2 people.
Yeah, I did my one-man show at the festival to 5 people, remember?
Exactly. I mean, that was because of a scheduling issue. You had to move it to the morning. So I would like to say that had some impact on things there. But it's different there because no one else fucking knows about it. Now you put out a video.
Fun with those 5. You can talk to them directly.
Oh, bro! Like I had the best time. I still talk about it with the show where we had like 2 women come down. They were down from Joburg. They saw the post online, and they were the only 2 people who came to the show. We did a full show. I was hosting it at the Winston. We had like 5 acts plus a headliner, and we just performed to these 2 people, and it was a banging gig. Like it was so much fun because you're all in it together now, you know, and as long as like they were on board with it, we were on board with it, it flowed and we got to do our material, we got to crack like, you know, jokes on the spot and have a fun time with it. So that's the thing. I don't think you can necessarily do that online. And the worst thing about the online thing is it's now because it's competitive and it's a rat race, other people are saying, yo, you only got 10 views for that thing. And, you know, it's now... And you're busy trying to get sponsors and you're busy trying to do all these things to try and make your stuff work. And it's become like, I think everyone's, as you say, everyone's taking L's online. I mean, I wouldn't say I took an L with Almost Live, but it definitely didn't go like the live video streaming thing. I think a lot of us are realizing you need to do a lot more than just call your friend on the phone, you know?
Yeah, it's been tricky. And so for me, when Smoker called me, he told me what this thing is doing, said if I'm from Keen, I'd like to obviously include me in what he's doing, because he usually includes me in everything he does. But I said to him, no, I'm not interested. But I'm happy he's doing it, because some of them do need an outlet and just haven't figured out their... Because, you know, you might be great online. Some people actually have found rhythm online and it's been good for them. And I would say that unless you try it, and some people are not self-starters, so good for you for setting it up. But for me, I said to him, I'm not really... I'm actually trying to avoid this online race. That was our conversation today. And then he still spoke to me about the show, and he said, oh, bro, you need to do the show. Why are you stopped doing it? I said to him, I don't feel comfortable chasing in this online space. I feel more at peace not doing it. And so
Amen.
I did it because I thought it was the thing to do. But now I know that I feel more at peace not doing it. And that's a simple calculation in my head of what to do next. Whatever equals peace is where you're probably going to find me. And so I decided not to do that. And I don't think I'm going to do
that. Is that a new thing? The wherever there's peace.
It's not a new thing. I usually do operate on that. But I think it's more amplified in this time.
But you also operate on the doing stuff that makes you uncomfortable, you know, scale as well.
Yeah. So I think in some senses, you do things that are uncomfortable until you get to a point where you're like fully conscious that this is not comfortable and it affects your peace, because you can't really judge your peace, how it affects something affects your peace, unless you do it. And sometimes you have to do it a few times to realize. It's almost like dating, right? If you date someone and you go on a date, you know, you're not 100% sure, but maybe there wasn't a spark and you go on a second date. And then by the third, fourth date, you kind of know that, no, this is not the person. Me and this person, we've got not much in common. This is not a comfortable space. And so you don't continue. Oh, some people do it, but you don't continue.
The outward appearance of the relationship is all you are really looking for. Yeah.
It seems to make sense. So let's say I'm dating different online career options. As I date them and I realize, I kind of step away. I don't force the relationship, if that makes sense, with these online ventures. And then there are those that kind of just become their own thing. So one of the things I did start was broadcasting like radio sort of style on my Facebook page. And I kind of realized that while I was doing it, is that people listen to certain music at home and in their car, but they don't have a outlet or like a media outlet that plays their music. So when you listen to East Coast Radio, you listen to Kagasi or Metro, the music they play on these stations on rotation is not the music many people actually play in their houses when they have a choice. So I kind of thought, well, if I created a little radio station vibe that played music people played, like that I know people played in their parties or in their house when you visit them, It might be closer to like people's musical preferences than opposed to the top 100 from the UK or whatever. That I don't know how radio stations choose their playlists. That kind of started as an experiment, but it's like really snowballed into something very, very, I'm gonna say, powerful, because it's I actually hardly go in air now. I started a full page called Radio Color and got all the DJs, some comedians who were keen, said get involved, you can have an hour slot, do what you like, and you know, I'm not gonna control what you do. And that's just been developing. I got some DJs from Australia, former Durbanites. It's a very Durban focused sort of effort.
It's necessary, because there's Cape Town, you know, has their TV thing, and like I think that's become a pretty necessary thing with the lockdown. It's still trying to do stuff, even though you're doing stuff with a broad audience in mind, it's still doing stuff locally, and providing that content's important, because that's really what people want to hear a lot of the time. For expats like this, I know from the stats of this podcast that people from South Africa who are living overseas love hearing stuff from Durban. They love hearing stuff from where they used to be. You know, they love hearing about what the people are still doing.
For sure. They have serious feeling of missing out when they're not on their way. And so, that expat audience is also quite big. And so because the expat audience is big, I decided to actually find some people that were DJs that are from Durban that now lived abroad. And that's been helpful because it also exploded the numbers on the page. So you must know the page is only about less than 2 months old, but it's already on like over 5,000 likes, and it's doing quite good numbers. I think it's like 2 million reach.
I'm just going to keep my jealousy to myself.
No, but and this is interesting because I don't even go on here, to be honest. I don't even get involved at all much. Because also it's not my space. I'm not really a DJ. I don't really understand. I also, while I was doing it, kind of started appreciating DJing a bit, because I realized that choosing what goes with what song goes with what, actually is a bit of a knowledge thing.
It takes definitely
a bit of time, and you know. And so when I was playing, it was at the point where I'd play a song and then people would write in the comments, like almost like we're mixing drinks. This song goes well with that song. And then I'd basically search the song they suggested while everyone was still playing and talking to them. And then play that song. And then someone else suggests, after that song, you just play this song. So the people were basically mixing in the comment section. Anyway, I was talking to Craig, who was the first person, DJ Craig, who was the first person I asked to kind of like join me. How none of this was planned. It wasn't planned at all. It was like just rolled as it rolled. And so it's even got advertising now, right? Each DJ can get sponsorship with such good reach. You can now make a bit of money off it, which is a bit bizarre to me. However, I don't have, what can I say, the passion to be on radio.
Sure.
I realize I don't have the energy and the passion for it.
I did it for 2 years and I realized the same thing.
And it's interesting because just before the lockdown, or just as we went into the lockdown, East Coast Radio had a job offer, which they kind of sent to me to get involved in what they do, right?
Yeah, I remember you mentioned that to me.
Yeah, and so part of the reason why I started the online radio station thing was to kind of test what it would actually be like. I never thought this thing would become its own thing. It was literally a moment for me to test if this would be fun. So as fate had it, I didn't take the East Coast job, and they did say they might come back at a later stage. I'll wait to see. I'm pretty sure I don't want to be on radio. And if I do it, I'm going to just be doing it like almost like courting again. I'm going to court it commercial radio and see what it's like. But from my experience thus far, I've been quite surprised. I thought, you know, because this is a weird thing, and I'm sure this is for you too. I thought for most of my life that I'd be a cool radio thought leader. That makes sense. I'll be on radio. Yeah. And lead thoughts and conversations. And, you know, you listen to radio and you're like, I can do this. This is not hard. And then a bit of music and what I thought. But I just felt like during this lockdown, it might be the lockdown, so that I don't want to actually be that accessible to people anymore. And I think being on radio is makes you extremely accessible.
I mean, we know one of our good friends has become a public figure because of radio and has... I think his life's become a lot more complicated because of it.
Yeah, it makes your life more complicated. So it's about figuring out the next place. I'll tell you what I am doing, though. So this is what this, and this probably is in some ways my way of segueing out of public space, but you have to stay within public space to make a living, is I've started writing movies. So I've submitted my first movie to the Netflix Impact Program. It's a movie
you're doing the what's we call it, the what's his name again, Ron Howard program. Me and another guy are busy pitching for the Imagination program with Ron Howard. I don't know about this program you're talking about.
No, so this is Impact, and they've produced quite a, I think it's close to 30 projects for Netflix over the last 2-3 years. Anyway, so I submitted a... So the first project submission was a family-friendly movie.
Oh, this is the same thing. Yeah. This is it. It's cool. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. So you're familiar. So I'm going to tell you what the story was. And literally, I've got two other movies I'm working on, which I'll get to now.
Yeah, because they won four pitches overall, right?
You don't have to do all four. But anyway, these two others had nothing to... This is before I even found out about the program. I had two movies I was busy working on. When this came around, they release the category, if I can call it that,
Yeah.
They release that at different intervals. So you don't know upfront what all four categories are as it comes to the enter. So the first category was animation or family-friendly adventure. Wow. Never really thought about that. However, I do have lots of ideas. So I literally, on the day I received it, wrote the whole story as I saw it in my head. And it's a South African story. It's about these Khoisan children that live in the Northern Cape. It's set at the beginning of the diamond rush, the discovery of diamonds in South Africa, the arrival of companies like De Beers, and how the mining encroached on the land of the Khoisan people. And it's a story about how they fight back, these children with courage, kind of lead this fight back against the corporations. And that's basically the whole plot of it. So I submitted it. I haven't had enough time to review it and go through it again and again. And I only know this because the other movie that I've been working quite aggressively on is The Real Ones. It's the story of Tiro. And I've literally just...
Documentary, or you're going to...
No, this is going to be based on a true story. So it's...
So like the notorious kind of thing.
Yeah, the story is quite dramatic, but it's also quite important because we're from the same area in Units East, right? So they're the first people that you hear on a public platform speaking in colloquial language that we spoke in Units East. Like, so it was a huge mind shift to think for me as a child. So I first saw them, I must have been like 10 or 11 when I first saw Tiro. And when they blew up, people don't realize this. They were like 16 and 17.
Dude, what's so crazy is, I was singing their songs in Umbilo, as an even younger kid, like having no clue that, these guys were teenagers. Like, it's crazy.
They were babies. But if you look back at the average age of making it in music now, they were very young for what they were doing, especially in South Africa. So they were like teenagers. I remember watching them at a school concert and being so fascinated by the cool, the swag. We didn't call it swag back then, right? But by the and the ease with which they were doing it. And then this thing of speaking slang and speaking with Durban colored accents in a way that people didn't find stupid or like uneducated. They made the way I sounded as a person, as a human being, acceptable. That was very important. That's very important because that feeds later into my comedy. It feeds into my career as a journalist, where I never feel the need to adjust my accent and to change much because TRO became a national. And when I was in London, people knew them there, an international brand doing things just as they were raised. So this story is very important, and it's taken me a long time to craft, because the story also has to be entertaining, and it has to have turning points, it has to have ups and downs.
Have you been like doing any online courses or any like YouTube channels or anything like that to like learn
Not
story
really.
Structure? And... Oh, okay.
I've had some help from movie makers or people inside the industry kind of reading through it and telling me, do this, do that, don't do this, tell us more about this. Because
so you haven't like read up on Dan Harmon's story circle or like anything like that?
No, I have watched a few videos of turning points, climaxes, and so character development. I've watched a few YouTube videos, but I wouldn't say I've done a course or studied it, if that makes sense.
Sure.
It's very casual viewing of thoughts, which is like how I do a lot of things actually. And so this movie is very important. It's absolutely, and now Netflix and Impact, same project, has just released their next category for movie submissions. And it's exactly this. Music, are you the next 8 Mile, Pitch Perfect? Do you have the next movie like this? And I was like, wow, okay, that's interesting.
Yeah, the funny thing is I've got my Almost Famous like in the canister for this one as well.
Oh, yeah. But this is the thing. I've also was advised to enter the local film, the KZN Film Commission's
submission. Yes, I was actually about to say that. The NF, the NFVF and the KZN Film Commission would both be great things for you. And if you haven't done the DIFF Film Mart, the Durban International Film Festival Film Mart, I know they're open at the moment. They're busy taking submissions for the Film Mart, which is happening, I think, very soon. I think it's next week or, yeah, starts from tomorrow. So, yeah, like there are options actually in South Africa, I think, for funding for especially that TRO piece. I think that is something that if you shop that around here, you can do pretty well. Even if Netflix doesn't take it, I think you can get a lot of funding from KZN Film Commission, from the NFVF, and then from various producers who, yeah, there's like I think that's a great idea that definitely needs to get done and can get done.
Yeah, and that submission closes tomorrow. So I will be sending it through to tonight. And I spent a lot of time with Daniel, who was Daniel still performs as TRO with Paul. Fabian passed away. The story goes quite deeply into those relationships. Some of it is fiction because it's based on a true story, but it's based on the actual events. So Funky Fabian passed away in a car accident in Ulysses with his brother. We kind of explore how TRO doesn't own their music till today. And the movie looks at how that can happen and how that still does happen. people don't realize it's more common than you think.
Yeah, and people want to hear that story from Daniel himself. Neil and I interviewed him for the Live from the Winston podcast. So people can Google that and check that out because it's a fucked up story. And it's something that happens a lot in the music industry, especially back in the day. You know, people used to sign their rights to other people thinking, hey, these guys are going to, you know, help make us something. Meanwhile, nah, these are just going to drain you, you know, blind for the rest of your career. Like, they're going to own your stuff and just be the ones making money off of it. And have you, like, in the comedy industry come across much of that?
Yeah, there's definitely that happening in this industry. One company in particular, I think, made a lot of TV specials. I think they paid guys $20,000 flat fee for the whole thing and then sold it to DSTV. I think that was the offer. The guys I spoke to, at least, that's what they were offering. And I remember when other deals started coming forward and we realized that people had been quite badly taken advantage of. And, you know, you'd be surprised. It's not like newcomers. It's like established acts. Because one of the things that you want to do, and when I first started, like, getting around comedy circles and I would get all these comedians from America for those Hunt Alive gigs, another story altogether. Nando's Comedy Festival. One of the things they would always do is introduce the act as, this guy's got a Comedy Central special. He writes for the Tonight Show. Like, those credentials were so important for the intros. So, which I didn't understand, but I was like, wow, this thing of having a TV special is a big deal in the world. Like, they don't take you seriously unless you can say
Yeah,
you got Comedy Central special, you see it, but SNL, all or whatever. SNL is a bit like big, but Comedy Central specials were a dime a dozen coming into the 90s. Everyone had one, you know? And a lot of those guys became
kind of like a modern Netflix special, you know?
Yeah, but
it's it's still an achievement.
Yeah, with Netflix, it's still a bit difficult for Netflix. I mean, how many South Africans do you know with Netflix specials? Like, I know Lisa and Madinga and Gola and
there was the comedians of the world. That was the main thing for South Africans. But
yeah, but out specials for us. Those were like 30-minute parts of a project. I think Riyadh actually has a comedy special on Riyadh Musa has a comedy special now on Netflix. Okay. But I think most like if you get a comedy special on Netflix, like a proper one, hey, bruh. You know, you've done great.
but South Africans didn't have Comedy Central specials back in the day, you know, and they still don't have Comedy Central specials that go to, you know, overseas markets. Yeah, like it's stuff that's recorded here, filmed here and, you know, screened here. It's, you know, owned by DSTV and whatever. So you're never going to get, like, seen or heard outside of that.
So there's a difference. Okay. There's a big difference.
Those ones. Well, that's the thing. Those are those ones. The modern ones are being done more for Showmax and that. Well, some people are doing stuff for sure.
Those types, there's a difference. There's a very significant difference in how those specials are put out and the ownership structure of those specials.
Want to explain it?
So, and I only know this because I've been asked by three different companies about getting involved in the TV recording. The one deal was from the company that's been offering $20,000 for like a standalone $20,000 take the money and run deal. The other company pays you a flat rate, but they have complete access to your comedy for as long as they feel like. Your rate covers that. And then the final deal, which is the one that I've taken twice, is the one that gives you it's a licensing deal, and they pay a flat rate for the content and for the show for a period of time. I mean, it comes back to you, so you never actually lose ownership. So you can resell it.
Yeah, that's the ideal way to go. But obviously, then the costs are going to be recouped and stuff like that. So you have a slight risk there where you might be the one, you know, on the hook for paying for the filming and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But
so
if you sell it, it should cover that.
The way those deals are structured. So in other deals, you don't have to worry about costs at all. You don't even know what the costs are. It could have been 1,000, could have been 5 rand.
You just get 20K and bounce.
You enter a partnership. So you actually have to know all those costs, because those costs do come out of your split, your flat rate split from GSTV. So if it costs 70,000 to shoot, you need to know that. And basically, the way those deals work, the only real cost there is the actual production of it. There's no marketing and post-marketing costs or anything that associates. Because remember, DSTV is a platform that's self-promoting. It promotes itself on itself. You can go on DSTV and watch DSTV advert about something up on DSTV. So it's its own little ecosystem. And so...
That's like Spotify, bro.
Yeah. And also because they've already paid you for it. So how many views or whatever it gets doesn't actually matter to you from a financial point of view.
Sure.
And for them, it's a risk. And it's gone both ways. Some people, they pay the flat rate with a special, play the special once. No one really liked it or, you know, didn't get much traction. And they basically, they don't burn it, but they don't play it again. But if they get a special and it gets good traction and it gets good numbers, like a good example is Dylan Oliphant.
Sure.
Out of all the specials that were purchased up until the point, I think just before the Nation Wild ones, and the most popular local, I don't really consider Trevor like a local comic, if that makes sense.
Sure. Yeah.
But the most popular local comedy special, as I understood, was Dylan Oliphant. What was that? Oliphant in the Room, I think it was.
Okay.
And that thing was like on heavy rotation. It would be moved across channels. You could catch it in the day. You could catch it at like 11 o'clock in the morning.
Dude, that thing jumped from DSTV to prior to DVDs. Like, that's how popular
it was. It was everywhere. And I think every now and then they still drop it because it's one of those specials that did well. So, you know, there was, I don't know, that's good for them. Maybe not so good for him, depending on what the upfront fee is, or good for him going forward. On the flip side, there's specials that have been played and literally like just played on Showmax, and that was the end of them. They never really got much TV play, and you know, that's the risk that they take. But
yeah, but at the same time there, you get to say, hey, I had a show on Showmax, so now going forward, your bookings, you're getting paid more, you know, you seem like a bigger deal than you were like before that happened. So it's still a worthwhile risk.
Yeah, it's a worthwhile risk, but I'm saying the risk is not so much for the performer as much as it is with DSTV, right? Because
sure,
they're buying a product that might not work. They only know after they bought it, and so they do have a tiered. I'm giving inside information. They do have a tiered payment structure based on. I don't want to say popularity. I want to say perceived popularity.
Sure.
So there's a perception that they have that certain people will do better than other people for whatever reasons, or they've already had requests or demands for a certain act. So when those specials are offered, those payment structures are tiered. Some people are offered X amount, some are offered X amount. And there's a top tier offer.
So what you're telling me is I need to tell everyone on Twitter, everyone that's listening to this right now, everyone on Facebook, to just hit up DSTV and tell them you want a Bob Perfect comedy special, and then I'll get paid more.
No, I don't think it's based.
Damn it.
Literally on that. I think, okay, and I'm spitballing it because I don't know for absolute certain, but, you know, might as well. They do have a perception that certain people might do well on their channel, as does any, like, you know, organization, radio station that gets a new DJ or whatever. They kind of go that this person would be a good fit. That makes sense. Like East Coast Radio got Fat Joe for whatever reason. I would imagine on a pretty big paycheck, it'd be a great fit.
Yeah, that worked out well.
And you realize, well, actually, it was a bad idea. It's a risk you take. So I think they take risks on a few people and say, this one we think will do well, so we're prepared to offer X amount. This one, we're not sure. We'd like to have it and see how it goes, so we'll offer X amount. And that's basically, that's as far as I understand the TV game in South Africa when it comes to comedy. However, there is a rumbling that Netflix is about to upset that apple cart just a bit. Because Netflix does, as far as I know, offer more money.
It also goes to way more people. Like, the thing is, getting on Netflix gives you a potential reach that is, it's just unfathomable. You know, you'll be able to tour for the rest of your life, like, if you get on Netflix.
If you're good. I got friends with Netflix specials that like, all over the world that, it did not. I've done shows with people with Netflix specials in, like, Asia and whatever, and people barely knew who they were. And, like, they were introduced. The one guy I did a show with, the guy has two Netflix specials. Two. So, you come into a festival and you're performing with somebody with two Netflix specials. In your head, you're like, this is going to be huge and insane. Everyone's coming to see this guy. Not the case. People barely know how to even find those specials. Well, you know, Netflix is a little conundrum, or it's a little, like, you know, maze of trying to find what you like. And until you develop a rhythm, it doesn't show you a lot of things.
Yeah, and you have to be a comedy fan to go, and because Netflix does have a ton of comedy specials, and if you haven't heard of half of those people, you're not going to watch the special. If nobody's told you, hey, this is good, go watch it, you're only really going to watch the names that you know, like, unless you're a proper comedy fan. But even me, like, I watch lots of comedy specials throughout the year, but there's thousands that are released every year, you know, like putting that Netflix comedy special or putting a BBC One comedy special or SABC comedy special or whatever next to your name, while it is an achievement, it's not necessarily, means that anyone knows who you are. Like, we know lots of people who have specials here in South Africa who are on Showmax, who are on TV, who their name doesn't really draw people in. Like, you put it on a poster. I mean, I just know this personally. You know, you put their name on a poster, you promote it, and they get 10, 15, 20 people. And, you know, these are people who have specials. So it's not necessarily this thing that we thought of. You know, back in the day, you thought, if I can get on TV, it's going to open up the world to me. Meanwhile, people are getting on TV and they're going back to their day jobs.
Another conversation, going back to day job, which I encouraged most comics to actually do at the beginning of the pandemic, back in March, before we knew how long it was going to last. I was like, go find a job. And guys were phoning, how long you think it's going to last? I was like, go find a job.
Yeah.
We'll be fine. I said, listen, I'm applying for jobs and I have an audience to work with. You've got no audience. You don't even have a fan page. Go find a job. And it took a while, but some guys were like, hey, I think it's time to find a job. And if you can find a job, take the job, because I don't see us returning. You know, you're talking about performing to two people in the Winston. And while you were talking, I was just having like a moment where the images of the Winston and us performing and standing by the bar and someone dying or doing well on stage and people sitting and those Winston benches laughing, all those images were flooding my head, and I realized what a beautiful thing we had, that we didn't live in the moment as much. as we should have. It was truly a beautiful experience to be able to express yourself that rawly. And you know, the thing about having a comedy club in Durban or anywhere is that comedy is that art form where you can have an idea in the day, kind of workshop it, write it out, or workshop it in your head, and in the night perform it and figure out if it works. There's not many art forms that can give you that sort of quick release of from concept to development to execution. Yeah. And so I just feel like retrospectively, those moments in the Winston and places like that were more beautiful than we realized. We were a lot less grateful than we should have been, because we were extremely blessed, Bob, to have been able to stand on stage and speak our mind,
and not have say things and be that are willing to fail, and having people there that allowed us to fail. You know,
people who, and you know, this is the thing about people when coming to your show. People have to give up an evening. They have to prepare. They have to stake their name by inviting someone else, saying it's going to be cool. They have to buy drinks. They have to find babysitters if they're older. Some of them,
they have to get an Uber if they don't have a car, or they don't want to drink and drive.
The cost to a human being of attending a show of yours is more than the ticket price that you see. In addition to the ticket price, there's all these other little bits and bobs that go together for them to dedicate a night of their life to you. And in some cases, especially the Winston, we had some people dedicating every Wednesday of their life to listen to us. And I really like look back at that period, and I'm like, I wish now that I knew then what I know now about how special it is. Because there were certain days we were just like, you know, I used to get frustrated sometimes when I'd come there. You're like, these people haven't prepared. They're just like, just getting up there and whatever comes in their head, they're just going with it. And I'm like, no. And no, that's more amplified now. That frustration, if I can say. But mostly, I would say it's more, what can I say? Not sadness, but like, you know, just like looking back and thinking, I wish
we'd done more. That's how I feel about it. I wish other people appreciated it more. genuinely.
Don't control everyone. I'm saying us. The guys who had the special opportunity, you know? You, me, and the millions of comics that you created. Well, not millions, but, you know, quite a lot, actually. It's probably tens and tens, dozens and dozens of comics that you,
probably
over the years,
50 or 60 came through there. Like if I look at all the lineups that we did, at least 50 or 60 Durban people tried stand-up comedy at least in the couple of years that I was doing underground there. Pardon?
It's definitely more than that.
We
can't argue without evidence and data yet. Would it be nice if I could register everyone who's ever tried?
That would be interesting.
What they're doing now in their lives. Some of them are right-wing activists online. It's interesting. Anyway,
yeah.
So I've been trying to find my peace, Bob, in the pandemic, and I realized that in that trying to find that peace, writing quietly is very peaceful to me. So the movie process, the writing process for the movies and stuff, has been where I found a little bit of, okay, I can hide a bit, yeah. I can still express ideas, but I can hide. I don't have to necessarily be in people's faces.
I was just saying this like the other day to someone I'm writing with, the guy who I'm pitching with for this Netflix thing, and that's one of the things that I've really been enjoying about script writing, because I've also been doing that this year. This year I'm working on a cartoon called Super Delinquent Squad, and then I've got a sitcom that I've been working on, and then I've got a movie that I've been writing, plus a short film, plus other things. But the most fun thing about it, it's like, I don't have to be the one saying this thing. The character is the one saying it. You know, it's like you can wrestle with ideas, because you can have dialogues between two people and they can wrestle out the entire idea. And you don't have to be the one like putting yourself on stage, like saying this fucked up controversial thing, or like you know, trying out, yeah, just different stories and different ideas that might be, yeah, like if you get on stage and say this thing, people would hate you for it. But if you put it in the mouth of a character, it then opens it up. It allows them to be a bit more sympathetic. It allows people to, yeah, consider the ideas a bit more, I think, sometimes.
Yeah, for sure. And you also, you know, the insecurity, you know, that comes with being exposed that much.
Oof, yeah. But did you feel that much? Because you always seemed like someone who didn't necessarily feel insecure on stage. Like, after a while, it looked like, you know, that was where you felt most comfortable.
You get better. You get better. You do. You learn your rhythm, and you learn the rhythm of an audience. So, you know, if Barcelona is going to play Kaizer Chiefs, are they going to feel insecure? Probably not, because, you know, they know themselves. They know they're better equipped. They got their tactics and their strategies. And so I think with stage performance, the more stages you perform on and the more diverse the audiences that you've stood in front of, the more equipped you are to deal with the night at the Winston or anywhere. And I think one of the unknown benefits of working in Durban is that you do play segregated audiences. So you do shows with just white people, and you do shows with just Indian people, and you do shows with just colored people or black people. And what happens then is, because people have, we have separate developments. So our common threads are not all the same, because our segregated society gave us different common points, just different common threads. We do have a lot of similar ones across groups in South Africa, but within groups, there are specific types, specific common points. Like, I'll give you an example. The issue over which school you went to, hey, bro, which school you went to? Like, when I got to college, that was new to me. Where I grew up, we never discussed what school you went to. They were all cock, so it didn't matter. There's no way you say, like, why my school is so much better than yours. Our school fees is 250 rand, you know what I'm saying? That's the separators. So, but in when I entered the white space, the Durban white space, I realized, wow, this is actually like a common thread of how you kind of classify and box each other.
So, and people relate to that well after school, bro. Like, sad. It's so sad.
Follows you for years into your life. Now, understanding that dynamic, and then also you must understand things like The Bluff is not a cool place. It's not a colored or black or Indian concept. For us, The Bluff is a cool place.
What is Umbilo like? Can I just ask? What is Umbilo like?
Okay, it's maybe not now, but growing up, Umbilo was also acceptable, very acceptable. If you move, you must understand where we're coming from. Umbilo is great.
Yeah, you see, so for me, as a white person who grew up in Umbilo and it became browner and browner around me, I mean, I didn't mind, but the white people around me definitely started to feel worse about themselves, if that makes sense. It was this weird, weird like thing watching... Yeah, like the environment become, more multicultural and just, but then you just hear like this, like Swat Gevaar kind of like stuff from the people around you. And it's just, it's incredibly disappointing. But nowadays, I think Umbilo is like a really dope multicultural space. Like I've got nothing but love for the place, even though it could definitely be looked after a bit more.
Yeah, I don't know much about what the demographics of Umbilo, but let me give you an example. When I was looking to buy my first house, I looked in Umbilo, because Umbilo, from where I was coming from, was a step up. It's only when I enter white spaces that I realize, well, you know, Umbilo is not really a place that you want to live in a rush.
Yeah, it. Like, I've been the poor white because I grew up in Umbilo. Meanwhile, like, for other people, that's like a step up. It's so, economy there is crazy.
So for me, working in Durban, and this is why I say this is one of the unspoken of benefits of being a comedian in Durban, is that you will have to work for that specific demographic, which means that you have to learn the nuances of that specific demographic. And if you're going to perform to that demographic for 20, 30, 40 minutes, you have to have an understanding of the dynamics and what they find funny, where their prejudices lie, to make that demographic laugh for 40 minutes. And then next week, you might be in Phoenix or Bellingham or somewhere, Astanga, and you have to understand the dynamics of that particular community, which is going to be completely different. If you said to someone in Phoenix and you told a joke about moving to Ambilo, that would not land, because they would not see Ambilo necessarily as a bad thing. Like, it wouldn't make loads of sense. Or the bluff, it wouldn't make loads of sense.
I definitely noticed that, like, with the thing, like, and I mean, I even had jokes about it, like, you know, like I would tell white girls I'm from Glenwood, you know, I'd tell white boys I'm from Ambilo, because then they wouldn't want to fuck with you. But like, yeah, like there's just these weird, like, little social dynamics there. But then, yeah, you try and, like, other people are just like, cool, bro, that doesn't make any sense. Ambilo seems fucking dope. How's it different to Glenwood? Aren't they the same place? And then you're just like, okay.
I maintain they are the same place. Penzance is in Ambilo, Glenwood. So you have to perform to those people for 40 minutes. So whatever you said to the people in Glenwood, Ambilo, or Hillcrest, you cannot really say the same thing or in the same way to the people in Phoenix. So you have to learn to adjust that delivery point or common threads that run in that community. And then if you're doing a show in Wentworth or amongst colored people, you have to, not maybe as much from Phoenix, but you do have to adjust that common thread again. So, and then again, you have to do this for 40 minutes or 50 minutes or an hour, whatever the case is. So you must consider how much more skill you would have over years of doing that.
Yeah.
Being
adaptable.
Yeah, and you know, and I don't know about yourself, but I also do the Zulu comedy scene. And that is another dynamic, because I'm performing in Zulu comedy shows in English. And so you have to, again, learn. These are now new nuances. Because if I told a joke about moving to even Newlands East, for some of them, that might be like, why is that bad? If I was living like in Sianda, Kwamashu, my family moved to Newlands East, that wasn't a bad thing. You know what I'm saying? So saying I'm from Newlands East or whatever doesn't have the same, like, oh, wow, you really started at the bottom. Because there's another bottom for some of those people in that audience. And so you have to learn that dynamic. And I think, this is probably a wasted experience for a lot of the comedians that worked very exclusively in the Winston white space, if I can call it that, that didn't get that nuanced training and skill to do the crossover.
I think there were some nights at the Winston where it was like you had to like actually play in the room. There were like, you know, different, like there were literally, you know, people from Nigeria, Indian people, colored people, white people, and that would create some very interesting nights, because they like trying to find a common thread amongst all these different, you know, multicultural backgrounds becomes even more challenging in its own right. But I agree with you there. The Winston did have more of a middle class whitish, although obviously we say that not meaning just white people, you know, came and watched, but it's that kind of idea and that kind of comedy, even though
culture.
It wasn't Ambilo. Yeah.
Maybe the black people over there understood that white middle class culture.
Yeah.
If that makes any sense. It's a very different experience performing in your neighborhood, in your hood, where people have never, you know, it's weird. People that followed comedy, or at least myself, from Newlands East, let's say where I'm from, or Wentworth, had never heard of the Winston. Many of them had never heard of it. And until, because they followed the comedy and they see, and they would come there, and then they would even inbox me afterwards and say, how can you bring us to a place like this?
Yeah.
The understanding of how comedy works was that it was a more classy, they saw you at the Playhouse, that's where they saw you.
Or you've also done the hotels and stuff like that. You know, your comedy is usually in spaces that are well lit with, you know, parking, like with, you know, security and, yeah.
It was always weird. And I would always say to them, but this is, you're actually getting, I'm a good spin doctor, you're actually getting a better deal here. Not only is it cheaper, but you're watching the product being made. everyone wants to maybe see a VW, but wouldn't you like to know how they put it together? Not everyone can see that part of the game. And so I'm trying to convince people that what you're actually seeing here is before it gets good. So one day when it's great, you can say, I was part of this journey of this joke.
But that is the sales pitch to, you know, tell people to go watch underground comedy, or even you go to Bulba Comedy Club, Kitchener's. There's lots of spaces where people are trying out different things, and you get to tell your friends when it comes out on Showmax, you go, I saw that joke when it went like this. It didn't, like, they've taken it from there and they've gone all the way here. That was a one line and now it's 5 minutes. And you get to be the person who's like, you know, the smart one in front of all your friends who really supports comedy, and not just the one who, you know, goes and watches Trevor Noah once every 3 years.
Do you think we're gonna get back to comedy even once a week? I don't know. I've given up on the idea that in 3-4 months it's gonna be normal or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
That possibility. I think whatever comes back is gonna be, it's gonna be a different thing altogether. Also, audiences are gonna be completely different. They're gonna be, there's also one of the tragedies of the pandemic for me personally is realizing how many people are not critical thinkers about things in general.
Okay, what do you mean there?
You know, one of the tragedies of this pandemic is that it's exposed a lot of people for being, I want to say easy to fool.
Sure.
Because a lot of people and this is people that your friends and people that you've hung out with and trusted are so ever ready to jump on every new conspiracy idea that comes out. And pandemics are great. They're great, like, breeding grounds for conspiracy theories, because there's a massive event, right? So there must be a massive reason for it. So the amount of conspiracies that have just continuously flowed from people that I would have thought would have given it some thought first before subtly choosing a side, something doesn't seem right here. You know, that sort of those lights. And the problem with this is that, of course, something's not right, like, you know, but to tag that onto a conspiracy, it made me a little bit upset as a person, because I thought the world was a more critical space.
But people still, like, you know, talk about the CIA creating AIDS and stuff like that, you know? So, I don't know, bro, like...
I
think it was inevitable.
There's complex conspiracies. Like, let's say, for example, where did AIDS come from? And was it from bushmeat? Was it from...
Fucking a monkey, bro. A scientist.
Well, yeah, was it from...
That's it.
HIV does exist. AIDS does exist in felines. It's feline AIDS, right? Lions. Where it came from, we can probably debate those sort of concepts, you know, for a long time, because there's so much information on it. But the ones that are popping up, like, every week there's a new one. And for so many of us to, like, take such strong positions on the conspiracy of the week, if I can call it that, has been quite surprising to me, because after people would have given things time to, okay, let's look at it, let's kind of assess. I mean, like, here's the one that really, for the longest time, just bothered me at the beginning, was the 5G the virus theory, right?
Oh, yeah.
And you know, now we're going, oh, yeah, at the time, it was a mountain of evidence that was being presented. Well, I'm calling it evidence, but it's their evidence, right?
My favorite thing was the hotspots, the people being like, this is where coronavirus apparently is, and this is where 5G is. And it's like, you put it, and it's just literally maps of where people are. Like, that's it. These are densely populated areas. So it's like, correlation does not equal causation.
Yes, correlation and causation. But now, so Bob, now we're looking at it, and I'm sure some of those people are looking at it and being like, oh, we're a bit silly, hey, thinking that, electromagnetic pulses from the can cause, or waves can cause a virus to develop. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, now it seems silly. But at the time, people were aggressive about it. I had people messaging me daily because some pastor had sent them a message from the UK greeting them in the name of God and telling them that this virus is caused by 5G. And I have my own mother asking me what I think of this. Wow. Now, my mother, I wouldn't consider my mother a critical thinker. She's a nice person, but I wouldn't consider her a critical thinker. But there's lots of people that I did consider critical thinkers. And the tragedy of this pandemic is that I realized that the world is a lot stupider than I thought.
I agree with you there. That's definitely something that I've come to terms with as well, which is why I've also like just tried to, like in the beginning of the conversation, you know, we were talking about withdrawing from like public life and stuff like that. For me, I've just been withdrawing from online life as much as possible because I'm just sick and fucking tired of just reading just constant fucking nonsense. Just people's unthought out opinions just being shared mindlessly, constantly. And it's just, I don't want to see this anymore. Like, I don't want to know, like, yeah, what you think about coronavirus most of the time, you know, like it's, and it's just, So for me, it's just been that thing of, like, I agree with you. I think the world is definitely a much sillier place than we even imagined last year. You know, like last year, 2019, things seemed pretty silly. Like it seemed like the world was just a chaotic mess. But now I'm just like, I don't even care about what's happening outside anymore. I just want to try and focus on what I can do and the people around me, you know?
I'm with you, Bob. Anyway.
Yeah, I think that brings us to the end. Yeah, that was a great chat. This has been like one of the first ones where I haven't like done the life story of somebody. You know, this has just been a full on opinion conversation, and it's been dope. I've been looking forward to doing the catch ups, especially because it's been nearly 2 years since we last chatted on this podcast. So it's a cool
reason. So the last 2 years have been quite important. I think when I spoke to you 2 years ago, I just come back from touring, right? Or I was about to go.
It was just after it was literally like the week of the awards like thing.
Okay. So the thing about then and now, I would say the most significant shift, and even before the pandemic, was that I decided that this year I wouldn't travel and I wouldn't go to places, and I would do my best to stay.
Why?
Because I was, what can I say, fatigued. No, I was over it. I can put it that way.
The dream wasn't what you thought it was.
It was. Like it was what I thought it was. And it was, and that was it. I don't have to recreate that experience. It was great, and I enjoyed it. And let's move on. It's almost like if you're at a buffet and there's all these different foods, and you taste something, and you're like, "Whoa, wow, that's amazing." You're not gonna stand by that one cake the whole evening.
I mean, I might.
I enjoyed the cake. You might. And I wouldn't. I'd be moving on. So I'm like, "Wow, this cake is awesome." But there's loads of other things there to kind of check out. So for me, it was great. It was an amazing time, and I'm extremely, even more so now, grateful. But I decided, like in the beginning of this year, that I would not be going anywhere. So I am one of those comedians, one of those traveling acts that had nothing to cancel. I feel like a prophet. You know what's funny? Bob, you're not in any of the comedy groups, but on the 11th of February 2020, I sent a message to all the comedians. I don't know if I told you.
I think I mentioned it,
that 2020 would be the year that everyone gets full-time, the full-time comics go back to full-time jobs.
the problem is a lot of them haven't even gone back to full-time jobs, you know?
We've really still got 4-5 months to go, right?
We'll see how it goes. I've seen a lot of people have been pivoting. I've seen some people have become motivational speakers. I've seen, you know, like a lot of interesting... Motivational speakers, yeah, you know.
Who became a motivational speaker?
South Africa's own Russell Brand, bro.
Huh?
I'll tell you off cast, but but yeah, it's an interesting time. We'll see how it all goes. For me, the biggest frustration is like my show, The End of the World. Like, if I could have just had that thing fucking out there, like during this, that would have been dope. You know, like it's, feel like I fucked up the timing there. I should have maybe tried to do more a bit quicker with it, but because I can't do it now, like, or after this. I feel like it would probably be in bad taste, maybe. But it's, yeah, we'll see. I don't know. I'm just like, cool, I can always just write another show. I can always do something else. I've got an idea that I want to do. I'm not going to mention it because I might not do it. But, yeah, there's different forms. There's different things that we can try and do in the space still. So I'm bummed about, you know, the fact that this weekend that we're talking right now would be the Heat City Comedy Festival and would have been pretty banging. But at the same time, you know, I've been writing movies. You've been writing movies. Like, that's something I think we've both probably dreamt about, you know, for years and never really tried. So there's always opportunities.
Okay. Cool. Do you still think, okay, but just before we go, maybe sure. A question for you. This week would have been the Heat City Comedy Festival. But Do you think that because you've become very vocal about some of your views about comedians and comedy, that you'd still be able to honestly put on a festival?
Yeah. I mean, but there's lots of people.
How would you reconcile using people in a festival and you don't really like it?
I would just work with people I like.
But there's like, not many. Right?
There's so many people. There's so many people I like.
You didn't leave a lot of people safe, if I can say that. So, and it's, you're not specific in saying I'm cool with this one or whatever the case is. So
yeah, that's
of course, the people that you like. But because your messaging sometimes is so broad, do you not feel like you've made a strong statement that's not specific enough to say not all men are trash?
Bro, here's the thing. I think if you feel touched by some of the things I say, then maybe we're not that cool. But if you don't feel touched by the things I say, because there's lots of comedians who are laughing at that statement, who are liking it, who are fucking with it. Like, that's the thing, dude. I'm just going to say and do my things now. Like, that's how I feel about life. That's how I feel about everything. And there's still lots of people I want to work with. Like, there's so many
people. I agree with you that you must prove your truth. But I'm saying, doing that...
It's also, dude, like, my Facebook page is so fucking small in comparison to the world, you know, in comparison to everything else. So, to me, like, it's not even, like, a big deal. There's a lot of people I don't fuck with in South African comedy, and there's a lot of people who I do, and a lot of those people have been on this podcast. I've booked them for lots of things. You know, I'm going to continue to do that. You know, I'm going to continue to work with people that I like working with, and I still believe in, you know, not necessarily Durban comedy, but I do believe in the industry, if that makes sense, or not the industry even, or just like I believe in comedy. I believe in making it better for the people who are doing it, where I am. That's Durban for now. It might not be forever, but for now, I would like to continually try and create cool things that I have a vision for. But I'm also not going to be shy about the fact that I'm not going to fucking work with a lot of the people who I think are fucky. Like, that's just the way I feel. I just feel like if you're a fucking joke thief, or, you know, you're a clout chaser or anything like that, fuck you. That's not for me. Like, you can do your thing, but it's not going to be done with me.
I'm with you. Okay.
But yeah, cool. I'm glad we could clear that up.
No, cool. I didn't intend to bring it up, but I thought it might be a nice way to say goodbye.
Yeah, we'll see. Like, I feel like this now might get shared a little bit more than it would have if you hadn't asked that. But we'll see.
All right.
Cool. Thanks for your time, Carvin.
Okay, take
care. We'll chat soon, bro. Later.
Congratulations on making it through to the end of yet another The Almost Perfect podcast. You have won yourself the opportunity to be promoted to. Yes, that's right. So you obviously enjoyed the podcast, so go and like it on Facebook. You can find us at Almost Perfect Media. We are also on Twitter, same thing, Almost Perfect Media, and on Instagram at Almost Perfect Media. You can also go to patreon.com/almostperfect, and you can buy yourself a mug for 100 Rand. Of course, 10 Rand from each mug sale goes to Sasonke, who are working to decriminalize sex work in South Africa. So yeah, hit me up, bob@durbanisyours.co.za, if you would like a mug, and go on and have a good day. G'day, mate.